get back to the Bible here. We're looking in John chapter 6 this morning, and I want to talk to everybody here in a way that the rubber meets the road. If you're preaching and it don't practically apply to your everyday life, that ain't much preaching. That's lecturing. But what the Word of God does is it has illustrations and things that have gone on that we can apply to our everyday life, because that's what it's all about, is how to live victorious as a Christian. So having said that, I look around this morning and I've talked to many of you throughout the weeks, and I realize that I don't think there's hardly anybody in here that does not need a miracle of one kind or another this morning. A miracle is about the only thing that would fix what you're dealing with. There are many of you in here that need a miracle for your health. The doctor has given you some bad news and no way out of it, but I'm telling you that the great physician is still alive and he is the way out of it. And you aren't going anywhere until he's done with you if you are serving him. But we're going to look at an illustration here of how to get that miracle in just a minute. Maybe some of you need a miracle in your home. Maybe some of you need a home. But I'm telling you, God owns it all. He's able to give you what he wants you to have. And so do not worry. Maybe you need a miracle in your family. Maybe they're running you crazy. If your family isn't running you crazy, you're not listening to them. You're an absentee parent. Lord. You know, I heard a youth pastor one time say that the best way to handle stuff like that when you're raising kids is when they get the age of 12, you put them in a barrel and feed them through a hole. Once they get 16, you just plug the hole. And I used to think that's the awfulest thing I ever heard, but anyway. Maybe you need a miracle in your job. And Lord knows, it's really getting tough out there today. Maybe you need a miracle in your school or your school work. God is able to give you the wisdom to do the work that you need to do. Some of y'all look around and I know you need a miracle in your relationships. Boy, just that quiet you got in here. Y'all think I'm gonna single somebody out. Shall I? Okay, I have to listen to what she says because I have to deal with her later. God is the God of relationships as well as anything. Marriages and all of that too. And he is able to give you that miracle. And finally, before we look at the scriptures, maybe you need a miracle in your ministry. We took a trip, Donna and I and Dawn, down to West Virginia on Friday. Our plan was to be there in 3 hours and 40 minutes, like the GPS said, and we were going to go to McDowell County to war in Yukon. But Dave took a shortcut. And it was 5 hours and 40 minutes before we got to West Virginia. I have no idea how we wound up where we wound up at. Something called Route 8. Well, it was fun, but man, it was long. And we didn't go to war in Yukon. We wound up going to Welch and North Fork. But I think God intended that. And we saw a need that was so great that the governor himself would throw his hands up in the air and probably say, I have no idea what to do. The need and the situation is that big. But you know what? We're the little tiny mouse that roared. If God calls us to it, he'll give us the resources to do what we need to do, and we will be able to do these things. We're gonna send some more down there to take a look at that pretty soon. It's absolutely amazing. But sometimes in your ministry, you get overwhelmed and you go, Lord, I got to have a miracle if I'm going to do this ministry that you have called me to. Well, good, because that's what he specializes in.
That's right. They can look at my Facebook for
Absolutely. Loads and loads and 100 and some pictures on Don's Facebook. So we see in John chapter 6, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. And a great multitude followed him. Now that is a key word. If you want a miracle from God today, guess what? You got to follow him. You just can't sit there and go, God, you got to give me a miracle, and then you're not following him. He's not obliged to do that for you, but you need to follow him, and you need to follow him closely, and you need to follow him with your whole heart if you want to get something like that from the Lord. The great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles, which he did on them that were diseased. God was able to do miracles then, and I'm telling you, he's able to do the same things today. We got to stop listening to the cessationist. Now, by the way, that's a person that believes there are no miracles anymore, and all of that stopped when the Bible was written. If you believe that, you are out of your mind. God is still the same God that he always was, and he still can do the same miracles. We've got to, first of all, follow him, and we've got to believe that he can still do it and quit listening to these little two-by-squirt preachers that don't believe it can happen anymore. And so Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Now, here's when it all gets started. When Jesus lifted up his eyes and saw a great company come to him, and I mean, that's a lot of people he saw coming up that mountain. He said to Philip, "When shall we buy bread that these may eat?" Now, God will ask you a question like that sometimes to see what you're going to do. And if you answer it with human logic and human reasoning, it ain't gonna happen. The miracle will not happen if you can somehow see how it can be done. God only works when it is impossible, when you cannot see how it possibly can be done, how it possibly can happen. That's the way that God works. God does not work on paper. I preached that all of my life, and I've seen it over and over and over. It does not work on paper. You can't get your calculator out and figure out God. It's just not going to happen. It's kind of like that math problem that a teacher asked a third grader and said, if your mother had six apples and she divided it with you, how many would she give and how many would she keep? And the kid said, well, I'd get five and she'd get one. And the teacher said, you don't know your math. And the child said, you don't know my mama. And that's the thing. A lot of people don't know our God, and that's why they said it cannot be done. And so Jesus asked Philip that question, when shall we buy bread that we may eat? And it said, he said this to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. God wants to prove you. In other words, to prove you to yourself that God is able. You've got to be thoroughly convinced that God is able. There can't be a shred of doubt in your mind. You've got to know that you know that you know that God can do these miracles, and he will. But he will ask you an impossible question to prove you. When shall we buy bread that these may eat? And he knew exactly what he was. God already knows what he's going to do. Already knows. But you know what? He invites you and I to be part of the miracle. Yep. I'm getting to the point. If you want a miracle, you got to be part of it. You got to get in there and do some things and be part of that miracle and not a spectator. We got way, way too many spectator Christians. that are convinced that you can come in on a Sunday morning, watch everything, go home, and everything's going to be fine. That's not the way Christianity works. And it's like Nick teaches on Wednesday night. You got the people like the Buddhist and all that bunch. They look at that as a way of life. Yeah. And we look at that at Christianity as just a religion. But it's, you know what? Nothing's going to happen for you if you look at it that way. But you've got to look at Christianity as a way of life. It's not just Sunday. It's just not just Wednesday or Thursday or any of the days that we meet together. It should be every single day. Either it's a way of life or you're not going to see anything happen in your life. So he invites you to be part of that miracle. He invites you to be the miracle. Yeah. So Philip answered him, said, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may take a little. That is 200 days wages of thousands of dollars. And he said, there's so many people here that even if we spent that, they're not going to get but just a tiny, not even going to get a little. And so here we go. Here's an Andrew. We need Andrews in this church. Christianity needs Andrews. What this looks like is the most ridiculous thing that, if you look at it from human eyes, it's the most ridiculous thing that ever occurred. But God does the ridiculous. I love it when he does this. Andrew, one of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said unto him, and this is great. He said, there's a little boy here which has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many? A child's lunch. They were not loaves of bread like you're picturing in your mind right now. 5 loaves of barley was like 5 little biscuits made out of the cheapest flour that you could buy. Wheat was a premium. It was worth 3 times the amount of barley. This was the lunch from a poor child. And he said he's got 5 barley loaves and 2 fishes. The fishes were about the size of sardines. We saw a food bank in North Fork, I believe it was, that had the name of 5 Loaves and 2 Fishes Food Bank. I believe God will bless them for naming it that. But what are they among so many? And you may think this morning, Lord, I need a miracle, but I don't have anything to offer you hardly. I have very little to offer you that would make any difference in the scheme of things. But what Jesus is saying to you is to use what you have and not what you could have. I hear people, oh Lord, if I got had $1 million, I could do this and I could do that. Do something with the $100 that you got. Use things for the glory of God. Now I'm not here telling everybody that y'all how much more money you need to plunk in the I don't care. God will talk to you about doing that. This is not a money sermon. This is a resource sermon of using what you have for the glory of God. Maybe it's a little bit of a talent. Maybe it is a little bit of a money. Maybe it's just I don't know what it is, but only you would know that. But use what you have and don't worry about what you could have. I think Bill and Linda have a song about that. I forget how it goes, but use what you got left. And Nick has a motto on that. That would you please tell me how that works about using what you have?
Use what you have, when you have, what you got.
There you go. And I never can get that right, and I was afraid I was going to mess it up. But use what you have. That's what God wants you as you are. He's not going to wait for you to finish this education and to go get this experience and go do this and do that, or wait till you got money. And God wants to use you just as you are. Do you remember the disciples that looked at that poor man that was looking for an alms or an offering, and he couldn't walk? And one of the disciples said, "Look at us." And the guy looked at him and they said, "Silver and gold have I none. But what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ, stand up and walk. That's the kind of people that the Lord's looking for. Not looking at your circumstances. And so Jesus told him, said, make the men sit down. Now there was much grass in the place. So the men sat down in the number about 5,000. Sometimes after you have offered God yourself and what you have left, it's time to sit down a minute and listen to what he's got to say. God wants you to be the miracle, but you got to listen to what he's saying. So Jesus took the loaves. You could put them in your palm of your hand, by the way, them five little biscuits. And when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples. This is the next thing you got to do. You look around at what you have and you thank God for it. Yes. One thing we have got to stop doing is whining. I have always been told that there's only one thing worse than a whining woman, and that's a whining man. I see a lot of you women shaking your heads and looking at your husbands. Oh my. Well, that's another sermon in itself. Whining husbands. All right. I might let one of the women preach on that one morning. Boy, I bet we'll have a thin crowd that day. Stop whining about what you got. And thank God for what you have. Amen. No matter how small it may be. I heard a pastor one time said, if you want to get out of your depressed mood, go sit down in just one room of the house and start thanking God for every single item in that room. And by the time you get done, you're good to go. Don't complain about what you own or what you don't have, but thank him for what God wants to hear you thank him. The Bible said God inhabits the praise of his people. And so we need to praise him for what we've got. And after I rode through Appalachia the other day, boy, I tell you what, I have nothing to whine about. And you know, a lot of them people down there don't complain at all. They're grateful for what God has done for them. So, give thanks. And then that's what he did. He gave thanks and distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were set down, and likewise of the fishes, as much as they wanted. And when they had eaten their fill, Jesus said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. He did that to show what little you can use for God and that he can still do great things with it. Therefore, they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which remained over and above unto them that had eaten. One basket could have held 50 of them little barley loaves. But he took 5 of them and fed. It wasn't actually just 5,000 people, by the way. It was 5,000 men. Most of them had their families with them. And most scholars estimated that a conservative number was 12,000 people that he had fed. And he had 12 baskets full of bread left over. Then those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, they said, this is a truth, that this is of a truth, that prophet that should come into the world. Later on in the chapter, Jesus gives another warning. And I think it was because he could see in the future what some people were going to do under the cause of Christ on television. You can get up in the morning, if you dare, very early, and thumb through the channels on the TV. And they got this supposed church service that comes on air. And all it is about is send me money and God will send you money. But you got to send me a ridiculous amount of money first. And basically, it's like a pyramid scheme is about all it is. And there are people that are constantly running to these ministries that promise health, wealth, and prosperity and all of that. And it basically are things of the world. But that's not the way God works. The reason he does that miracle for you, with your health, with your finances, with your family, with your relationships, with your job, and with your school, is so you can do things for the glory of God, that you can accomplish his work. And I'm going to read what his work is in just a moment. But all the way down in verse 26, Jesus answered them and he said, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled." There were a large number of people that were looking for Jesus to fulfill the flesh, and they did not get the big picture of why Jesus did miracles and why he did great things for people back then. They didn't understand it. And he said, "Don't work for the food which perishes," because he's going to supply that. Oh, I know they're hollering right now. Oh, we're going to have a food shortage. Very similar to the pandemic. This is a planned food shortage. 22 food manufacturing companies have burned to the ground in the last 2 months. And listed on the police report is cause unknown. And they may do what they wish. But you know what God said? "I've never seen the righteous forsaken. I've never seen his seed begging bread." God's going to take care of you if you are one of his and you are following him. Don't worry about this garbage. God's going to take care of it. So he said, "Don't labor. Don't work for the meat which perishes for that meat, but for the meat that endures forever unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed." So the miracles that God will do with you, if you will trust him, and if you will give him what you do have of your life, yourself, your time, your talent, whatever it is that it's going to take that God wants from you, your service, he does that to further the work of God. They said unto him, "What shall we do that we might work the works of God?" Here it is, real simple. Jesus answered and said, "This is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent." It's all about souls. These miracles that I wrote, sketched down here, your ministry, your relationships, your school, your job, these are not for you to use selfishly. The miracles that God will do with your life is all so you can be empowered to reach souls. I don't care how terminally ill the doctor says you are, if God wants you to stick around to reach souls, you're going to stick around. I don't care how poor you are. I don't care how big that ministry looks that you just feel like a peon. If it's done to reach souls, God will empower you to do it. Your prayer and my prayer should be, "Lord, let me do the work of God. Do a miracle with my life and the things that are keeping me from being a miracle. Do that in my life so I can use it to reach souls." As long as you are doing the Father's business, you're untouchable. You will not starve. You will not die. You will not go without a single thing. When it's time to come home, what did the girls sing? "I don't care what you do with me, I'm going to be free." We need to get out of this fear of these earthly things that everybody else is in terror of every day, and realize who you are and who you belong to and whose job you're on. You are working for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so we need to start acting like we are. We need to start becoming ambassadors of Christ, realizing, like that time that Paul was putting sticks on a fire and a snake came out of the fire, a viper, and fastened onto his hand, and he shook it into the fire. And they all watched and waited for Paul to die, and he didn't. Why? Because he was busy doing the Lord's work. No matter what Satan will throw at you, he will not win as long as it's all about souls. Not you, not me. It's not about any of us. Get the big picture, people, and let's get on board with the big picture this morning. Shall we stand?
Don't matter where you bury me.